For people in southern Putnam County, loud noises in the sky this past weekend literally rocked their world, and not in a good way.
Guys, what is going on?
Mysterious booming sounds that echoed through the sky of southern Putnam County left people shaken by this past weekend. Also, residents of North St. Louis County has claimed to hear strange noises from the sky, but have not been able to determine the source of the noise. Not only in Western countries, in the heart of the Holy Land, this mysterious sound is heard even clearer in the emerald sky of Jerusalem. It is not the sound of bells from ancient temples or churches, but the mysterious, majestic, and scary sound of a trumpet. The people passing by felt trembling when they heard that trumpet sound, like a prophecy of destruction. Apart from being inexplicable and sparking curiosity in the scientific community, these strange sounds have left indelible prints of fear in people grappling with its significance and possible implications. These strange noises, reported around the world, have sparked questions about their meaning and whether they could be a sign from above. Imagine hearing such an unexpected and unsettling sound. What would you think? For some, it's a sound unlike anything heard before. A haunting, otherworldly cry piercing through the darkness. But what are these sounds, and where exactly are they coming from? Or are these the fulfillment of biblical prophecy concerning the end of the age? Join us in this video as we unravel the mysteries behind these strange sounds. The terrifying sounds from the sky are described as a mix of deep rumblings, metallic screeching, and haunting wails. Witnesses worldwide have reported hearing them, often occurring without any apparent source. The widespread nature of these sounds has raised concerns and speculation about their origins and meaning. Residents northeast of Oklahoma City are saying a loud, shrill noise is keeping them up at night. Moreover, people from different countries have reported hearing them, leading to a global discussion on social media platforms, news outlets, and online forums. The crazy part? No one knows exactly what it is or where it's coming from. These strange sounds are said to send cold shivers down people's spines. Some believe they could be signs of something big, maybe even the world's end. Consequently, the Bible discusses future events, including what will happen before Jesus returns. By studying the Bible and history, we can find clues. It's not just about facts, it helps us understand God's promises and prepare for the future. So, before we explore these strange phenomena happening around the world, their potential meanings, and possible implications, let's examine the Bible's stance on the signs of end times and biblical prophecies concerning the apocalypse and the second coming of Christ. Is there a connection between what is happening now and biblical prophecies about the end of the age? Or is it a natural phenomenon? One of the most prominent references to celestial sounds in the apocalypse context is the book of Revelation attributed to the Apostle John. In Revelation 8:1, John describes the opening of the seventh seal, which unleashes a profound silence in heaven for about half an hour. This silence is then followed by the introduction of seven angels who are given seven trumpets, Revelation 8:6. These seven angels who had the seven trumpets prepared to sound them, Revelation 8:6. These trumpet blasts serve as a precursor to various judgments and cataclysmic events that unfold upon the earth. The imagery of trumpets sounding from heaven is reminiscent of Old Testament accounts, particularly those found in Exodus, where the trumpet accompanies the manifestation of God's presence and divine intervention, e.g., Exodus 19:13. Also, in Revelation 11:15-19, the sounding of the seventh trumpet marks a pivotal moment in the apocalyptic narrative. This passage heralds the culmination of God's plan for redemption and judgment, signaling the imminent return of Jesus Christ and the establishment of God's kingdom on earth. This momentous event is accompanied by celestial phenomena, including thunder, lightning, and an earthquake, bringing to the fore the magnitude and significance of the occasion. The sounding of the seventh trumpet represents the climax of God's redemptive purposes, culminating in the defeat of evil and the triumph of righteousness. But that's not all. Interestingly, in addition to trumpet blasts, the New Testament also speaks of the archangel's voice as a sign associated with the second coming of Christ and the end of the age. In 1 Thessalonians 4:16-17, the Apostle Paul describes the future return of Jesus Christ with the sound of the trumpet of God and the voice of the archangel. This passage, often called the rapture passage, describes the resurrection of believers and their gathering together with Christ at his second coming. The archangel's voice serves as a herald of this momentous event, signaling the fulfillment of God's promises and the ultimate redemption of his people. What's more, the concept of sounds from heaven, as signs associated with the apocalypse or the second coming of Christ and the end times, is a recurring theme in biblical prophecy. From the trumpet blasts of Revelation to the voice of the archangel heralding the return of Jesus, these celestial phenomena serve as reminders of God's sovereignty and the ultimate fulfillment of his purposes in history. As believers await the fulfillment of these prophecies, they are called to watchfulness, faithfulness, and readiness for the coming of the Lord. It is also believed that God will use supernatural signs in the heavens to signal the beginning of his intervention, to punish humanity for our sins and rescue us from self-destruction. Could these strange happenings in the sky be a sign in heaven for the world? But what are these signs? Signs in heaven according to the scriptures, pointing to the end of our lives. Are we really in the last days, and is the world about to end? This is the moment you've been waiting for to find out. Like, if he came back now, it'd be great. Well, there are a lot of people that think that that might be coming. So, in the Bible, through the prophet Joel, God spoke of astonishing signs in the heavens before the coming of the great and awesome day of the Lord. God gave this message to Joel for those living in the last days. I will show wonders in the heavens and in the earth, blood and fire, and pillars of smoke. The sun shall be turned into darkness, and the moon into blood before the coming of the great and awesome day of the Lord. The prophet Isaiah also described these same events when he said that the stars of heaven and their constellations will not give their light. The sun will be darkened in its going forth, and the moon will not cause its light to shine. Interestingly, the prophecies of Joel and Isaiah match the events described by the Apostle John in a vision of the end time, where he said, "I looked when he opened the sixth seal, and behold, there was a great earthquake, and the sun became black as a sackcloth of hair, and the moon became like blood, and the stars of heaven fell to the earth as a fig tree drops its late figs when it is shaken by a mighty wind. Then the sky receded as a scroll when it was rolled up, and every mountain and island was moved out of its place. When this sixth seal is opened and these heavenly signs are revealed, it will dramatically affect those who see them. God will orchestrate these signs in the heavens to announce that he will now intervene in human affairs." So, drawing parallels to biblical tales of divine judgment, such as Noah's story, there is a palpable sense of urgency among the faithful, urging others to repent and prepare for what may lie ahead. This sense of urgency is not confined to any particular religious denomination. It transcends boundaries, uniting believers from diverse faiths in a shared sense of apprehension and anticipation. Leaders within religious communities have seized upon these phenomena as opportunities to reaffirm their teachings and rally their followers towards spiritual awakening. Sermons echo with calls to heed the signs of the times and turn towards God in repentance, lest they be unprepared when the final reckoning arrives. The parallels to biblical prophecy are striking, with many believers drawing connections between these modern-day phenomena and the apocalyptic events foretold in Scripture, from the book of Revelation to the words of Jesus. A wealth of passages speak directly to the current state of affairs, fueling speculation and interpretation among the faithful. But what of those who do not subscribe to religious beliefs? For them, the sounds remain a mystery, a puzzle to be solved by science rather than faith. Yet, even among skeptics, there is a sense of unease, a recognition that these phenomena defy conventional explanation and hint at mysteries yet to be uncovered. Consequently, scientists and researchers have offered various theories to explain the strange sounds, ranging from atmospheric disturbances to electromagnetic interference. Yet these explanations need to fully account for the scale and complexity of the phenomena, leaving many questions unanswered and fueling further speculation. However, amid this uncertainty, one thing remains clear: the resounding echoes of the apocalypse serve as a wake-up call for humanity, a reminder of our collective vulnerability and mortality. Whether viewed through the lens of religious prophecy or scientific inquiry, these phenomena compel us to confront our deepest fears and contemplate the fragility of our existence. In times of crisis, seeking solace and meaning in the face of uncertainty is natural. For believers, this may take the form of prayer and repentance as they turn towards their faith for guidance and reassurance. For others, it may involve a search for answers, a quest to understand the mysteries of the universe and our place within it. Ultimately, the significance of these phenomena lies not just in their cause, but in their impact on the human psyche. They force us to confront our mortality, to grapple with questions of meaning and purpose, and to consider the possibility of a future beyond our comprehension. As we gaze upon the night sky, listening to the distant echoes of the unknown, may we find the courage to seek truth, embrace hope, and stand. My dear friends, brace yourselves for the revelation that awaits us is both shocking and profound. As we continue to unravel the mysteries surrounding the haunting sounds from the sky, we are confronted with a revelation of biblical proportions. For alongside these horrifying sounds, there have been reports of a most remarkable occurrence, the appearance of Jesus Christ himself. Yes, you heard that correctly. Witnesses from Jerusalem and beyond have reported sightings of the Savior amidst the cacophony of sound, a sight that defies rational explanation and challenges our understanding of the world around us. What does this amazing event mean? How does it fit with Bible prophecies about the end times? To understand, we need to revisit the holy texts, specifically the Book of Revelation's prophecies about the end times. Here, we find descriptions of Jesus Christ returning in glory to judge the living and the dead, and to establish his kingdom on earth. Listen to the words of Revelation. Behold, he is coming with the clouds, and every eye will see him, even those who pierced him, and all the tribes of the earth will wail on account of him. Could it be that the appearance of Jesus alongside the horrifying sounds is a sign of his imminent return? Are we witnessing the fulfillment of ancient prophecies and the beginning of the end times? The implications are staggering, and they demand our attention and our contemplation. For if indeed these events are a prelude to the rapture, the gathering of the faithful to meet the Lord in the air, then we must be prepared. We must examine our hearts and our lives, repenting of our sins and turning to God in prayer and supplication. But let us not despair, for even in the face of such uncertainty, there is hope. For as it is written, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life." Let us cling to this promise, and let us hold fast to our faith in the midst of the storm. As we await the unfolding of God's divine plan, let us remember the words of Jesus himself. "I am the way, and the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." In these troubled times, let us turn to him for guidance and strength, knowing that he is with us always, even unto the end of the age. My dear friends, the revelation we are about to delve into is nothing short of astounding. As we continue to grapple with the enigmatic sounds from the heavens, we must now turn our gaze to the spiritual significance of these events. For instance, the Psalms offer vivid imagery of redemption, with Psalm 51:7 stating, "Purge me with hyssop, and I shall be clean. Wash me, and I shall be whiter than snow." This verse encapsulates the transformative power of divine forgiveness, using the whiteness of snow as a metaphor for the restoration of purity. Similarly, the book of Isaiah provides another compelling reference to snow's symbolism in the context of redemption and forgiveness. Isaiah 1:18 declares, "Come now, let us reason together, says the Lord. Though your sins are like scarlet, they shall be as white as snow. Though they are red like crimson, they shall become like wool." Here, snow represents a divine promise of absolution, a powerful image of how the gravest of sins can be cleansed and made anew. The snowfall in Mecca, therefore, transcends its immediate physical impact, evoking deeper spiritual reflections on purity, cleansing, and the possibility of starting afresh. For believers and observers alike, this event prompts contemplation of divine grace and the universal longing for forgiveness and renewal. It serves as a visual and symbolic manifestation of the hope that, regardless of the depth of one's transgressions, there is always a path back to purity and grace, as signified by the pristine and untainted nature of snow. As we delve into the symbolic resonance of the snow in Mecca, we explore its biblical connotations and the profound spiritual reflections it invokes. This event, set against the backdrop of one of the holiest cities, invites a global audience to ponder the timeless themes of redemption, purity, and the transformative power of divine forgiveness, as encapsulated in the biblical symbolism of snow. Warnings against false prophets and deception. We're diving into a topic that's pretty important for a lot of people. Staying true to what you believe in, especially when there are so many voices out there trying to lead you in different directions. The big focus here is on a warning that's been around for a long time about folks who might come along claiming they've got the inside scoop on what God wants, but who might actually be leading us away from the real deal. So, there's this big talk about false prophets, which is kind of like people who pretend they're giving you the good word from above, but are just making things up as they go along. And it's not just anybody saying this. It's coming from way back, from teachings that many hold dear. Jesus himself is said to have given folks a heads up about this, even going so far as to name names, pointing out Muhammad as someone to watch out for. That's a pretty bold claim, saying that he might be leading people off track, away from what's truly right. This isn't just some small-time warning either. It's serious business, with ancient texts like Deuteronomy and 2 Peter throwing in their two cents, showing just how risky it can be to follow the wrong leader. They talk about how these false prophets can mess with your faith, pulling you away from what you know in your heart to be true. The real takeaway from all this talk is about being on your guard and making sure you're not swayed by every new idea or person claiming they've got the answers. It's like a reminder to stick to your roots, to what you've always believed to be true, even when it gets all muddled up with fancy words or new ideas that seem all right at first glance. So, as we go about our day, it's worth keeping an eye out, making sure we're not led astray by someone who talks a good game but isn't really on the level. It's about holding tight to what we know is true, and not letting anyone shake that foundation, no matter how convincing they might seem. Recognize true signs. Now, there's been a lot of chatter about figuring out who the Antichrist is and all that. But here's a thought. What if we spent more time looking for the good stuff, the true signs from above, instead of getting all caught up in the scary stuff? The message here is pretty clear. It's like a gentle nudge to remind us to keep our focus where it matters, on God. Instead of getting all tangled up in trying to spot the Antichrist, or getting lost in all those end-of-the-world talks, why not look for the positive signs, the ones that show us we're on the right path? It's about tuning into those moments or feelings that reaffirm our faith, the kind of signs that make us feel closer to the big guy upstairs. These could be anything from a sense of peace during a tough time, a helping hand when we least expect it, or even a beautiful sunrise that reminds us of the world's wonders. Staying true to our faith means keeping our hearts and minds open to the good signs and the divine nudges that guide us along the way. It's about trusting that we're being looked after and that there's a bigger plan in motion. So let's keep our eyes peeled for those moments that bring us back to what's truly important, and let's not get too sidetracked by all the noise. After all, the journey's a lot brighter when we focus on the light. Touching on something pretty close to the heart, building a personal bond with God. It's like getting back to the basics of faith, where it's all about you and the big guy upstairs, one-on-one. And with all the talk about the second coming of Christ, it's a nudge to not just wait around, but to get ourselves ready by living right. So, how do we do that? It's about more than just following a bunch of rules. It's about filling our lives with love, being quick to forgive, and holding on to our faith like it's our lifeline. Imagine treating everyone you meet with kindness like you would an old friend. And when someone messes up, instead of holding a grudge, you let it go and move on. That's the kind of stuff that makes for a holy life. But it's not just about how we act. It's about what's in our hearts. Keeping that connection with God strong and steady means talking to him, not just when Figuringo is sideways, but all the time. It's like keeping a line open where you can share your hopes, your worries, and even your everyday thoughts. As we gear up for whatever the future holds, including the big event of Christ's return, the key is to keep our hearts and lives in check. It's about making every day count, living in a way that's full of love and light, and keeping that personal chat with God going strong. That's the real prep work for what's to come, and it starts with us, right here, right now. A call to discernment. figuring out the real deal when it comes to worship and not getting fooled by the fake stuff. It's like being a detective on your own spiritual journey, making sure you're following the truth and not just some flashy imitation. The big message here is about staying sharp and not letting those false gods trick you into going down the wrong path. It's a wild world out there, with all kinds of ideas trying to grab your attention. But not everything that glitters is gold. That's why it's crucial to keep our eyes peeled for what's genuine and what's just a decoy. Now, when it comes to knowing who to listen to and what to believe, there's no better guide than the teachings of Jesus. It's like having a map in your hands when you're navigating through a thick forest. His words are like a flashlight that helps us see clearly, showing us the way to go and warning us about the pitfalls along the route. But here's the thing. It's not just about avoiding the bad stuff. It's also about actively choosing the good. It's about filling our lives with the kind of actions and thoughts that reflect true worship and devotion. Think of love, kindness, and a helping hand to those in need. These aren't just nice ideas. They're the very essence of what it means to walk in the light. So, as we go forward, let's make a solid commitment to discernment. Let's promise ourselves to test the waters before we dive in, to question what doesn't feel right, and to lean on the timeless wisdom that's been guiding people for centuries. It's all about sticking to the path that leads to the true light, not getting sidetracked by the flashy signs pointing elsewhere. Moving forward, let's commit to being discerning, questioning what seems off, and sticking to the tried and true wisdom that has guided many before us. It's about following the true light and keeping our faith strong, no matter what comes our way. In the end, it's our devotion and steadfast faith that'll keep us anchored, no matter how strong the winds blow. So let's hold tight, stay true, and keep marching forward with our eyes on the prize, a life lived in genuine worship and unwavering faith in God. And may the sounds from the sky serve not as a harbinger of doom, but as a call to action, a reminder of the eternal truths that transcend time and space. In closing, I leave you with these words of encouragement. Be strong and courageous. Do not be afraid. Do not be discouraged, for the Lord your God will be with you wherever you go. Joshua 1:9. May you find peace in the midst of turmoil, hope in the face of despair, and love in abundance. And may the grace of God sustain you now and always. Amen. Amen.